As the title suggests, I will essentially talk about Galileon cosmology in presence of torsion. And this has been done with collaboration to some people in Aseem Center in Kolkata. This is just a brief outline of my talk. First, I will talk about Galileon cosmology when torsion is not present. Then I will try to say what effects space-time torsion can have on the Galileon field. I will try to explain these fields as I proceed. And finally, some possibility to have late-time acceleration in the context of this model. So let us start with the structure of a Lagrangian. Generally, we construct any Lagrangian based on the symmetry properties, for example, maybe general covariance. But that does not exclude a large class of Lagrangians. For example, there is no principle that can exclude to construct a Lagrangian, which depends on Q, Q dot, as well as Q double dot. But it turns out there are interesting instability issues which arises when you add such second derivative terms to the Lagrangian. For example, if you try to construct a Hamiltonian out of this Lagrangian, then you essentially need to define two generalized coordinates. This Q1 essentially stands for Q, and this Q2 essentially stands for the Q dot. And P1 and P2 are the corresponding conjugate momenta. As you can explicitly see that this Hamiltonian is linear in the momenta P1. And whenever the Hamiltonian is linear, that essentially suggests that it is unbounded from below. And since Hamiltonian is a measure of energy, that essentially means that the system is unstable. So therefore, we actually cannot have a term which depends on double derivative in the Lagrangian, modulo a caveat. The caveat is that you can actually construct some Lagrangian which are degenerate in the sense that the double derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to Q double dot is zero. And the most familiar example of it is Lovelock gravity in a general context or our Einstein-Hilbert action or GR in a more broader perspective. So in Einstein-Hilbert action, you have the Rishi scalar as the action describing the dynamics of gravity. And Rishi scalar, as we know, depends on double derivative of the metric, but the Einstein's equation are still of second order. So the reason is the double derivative comes only linearly, so that the double derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to double derivative of the metric vanishes, and hence we have well-behaved solutions. Now the question is, that was in the context of GR or in the context of gravity, whether we can construct a very similar Lagrangian in the context of scalars. And that's the name the Galileon Lagrangian comes from. It was first introduced in this paper in 2008, and you can see this particular article for a review on this topic. So for a scalar field as well, you can add additional terms involving double derivatives of the metric and which does not, lead to any violation, and it will still be stable because the equation of motion would be second order. In four dimension, it turns out that you can add three such additional terms in addition to the canonical kinetic term of the scalar field. And the first such non-trivial term essentially takes the following form. So this del mu phi is the canonical term, modulo the minus half factor, and the box phi is sitting in the Lagrangian. As you can explicitly see that it is linear in the double derivative of phi, therefore you essentially, it's a degenerate Lagrangian, and hence the field equation that you get out of this particular Lagrangian only involves double derivative of the field phi, no higher derivatives appear, and hence you essentially get out of the Ostrogravsky instability in this case. So the next thing is that there is another way to motivate this. So in the context of flat space-time, you can see that the Lagrangian is invariant in the sense that the two Lagrangians can only differ by total derivative if you make the following transformation, that is phi going to phi plus b mu x mu plus c, where b mu and c are both constants. So you can either say wherever I have eta mu nu, I will replace it to g mu nu to go to curved space Lagrangian. Or you can say I want a demand invariance under the following transformation. That means you localize the symmetry, and incidentally that also lead to the exact Galileon term. The only difference is that if you consider the higher order terms, as I mentioned here, that this is just the first such non-trivial term. There are two more terms in that particular action. They will involve non-minimal coupling. This is essentially because the commutator of covariant derivative is not zero in curved space-time. It depends on the Riemann. And from there you get the non-minimal coupling. The next thing that you can ask, that what happens to cosmology if I do with this Galileon Lagrangian? There are two aspects that you can look for. Either you can look for inflationary cosmology or you can look for late time acceleration. So this particular paper discusses the late time acceleration part, and that's what I will concentrate on. So there, in accordance with the homogeneity and isotropy, as Pavan has already mentioned, you can essentially demand phi going to phi of t. In that case, you can compute the energy density and pressure associated with the first such non-trivial modifications to the Galileon Lagrangian, and that essentially corresponds to these two expressions. As you can see, half phi dot square is your usual kinetic term from the canonical part, and this alpha h phi dot cube and this particular contribution comes from the presence of the Galileon Lagrange. You can explicitly demonstrate from this that, which is a bad thing, that the equation of state parameter always satisfies this particular condition, that it always remains between 1 and 1 upon 5. And that essentially says that there is no way you can get late time acceleration out of this. So there have been several proposals that how you can get the late time acceleration. For example, you can break the Galileon symmetry to get the late time acceleration. So you can either break it partially, like you can say only I have this particular sector remain, which essentially boils down to adding some arbitrary or multiplying some arbitrary functions of the canonical term to the Lagrangian, or you can include a potential and break it completely. So such scenario I think will be discussed by Shreya in the later part of this session, so you can listen to her. But this essentially defeats the motivation of having the Lagrangian in the first place because the symmetry transformation does not exist. But furthermore, if you add those L4, L5, the higher order terms, then again you can still get the acceleration. But the point is whether we can get it with the most minimal possible correction. So for that, I came back to the case that there is one essential ingredient to the space-time structure which we are missing. And that is essentially the case of torsion. So in general, there is no reason to believe that the connection that we work with is symmetric, and it's essentially a condition that we impose on our textbook. And you can essentially have some asymmetric part as well. And in general, you can write any connection in the form of our known gamma, which can be expressed in terms of derivatives of the metric, plus some particular tensor, which is k mu alpha beta, and it is essentially defined as the contortion test. The antisymmetric part of this particular tensor is what defines the torsion tensor, which is t mu alpha beta, and as the structure suggests, this is antisymmetric in the lower two indices alpha and beta. But what about the symmetric part? To fix the symmetric part, you essentially impose the metric compatibility condition that the metric is covariantly conserved. And when you impose this condition, the symmetric part is also gets fixed, and your torsion tensor determines everything. Now, the symmetry of k mu is essentially in the first and the last indices. So if you interchange mu and beta, it is antisymmetric, as you can check by using the symmetry properties of the torsion. But there is one interesting thing is that if you want to consider and you want to get back to the Einstein's equation, so in the context of vacuum, suppose I want to get Einstein's equation. Now in vacuum, you want to vary your action, which of course involves torsion, and you have two independent variables, the metric and the contortion tensor. So the variation of the metric, as we know, will essentially lead to the vacuum field equations involving torsion, but the variation with respect to the contortion tensor, which is k, will lead to this particular equation, because there is no source term present on the right hand side. If I now take the trace of this equation, so incidentally this t nu corresponds to the trace of the torsion tensor, that is if you contract for example these two indices sigma and mu. So if you again contract this particular equation on sigma and mu indices, you can easily see that essentially what it boils down to, that the trace part vanishes. And if you again put that trace part back into this equation, you essentially get torsion has to vanish. So what it means that in the case of vacuum, the field equations for this particular theory, which is known as the Einstein-Kartha theory, is same as those of Einstein gravity with zero torsion. So therefore, matter is essential. So in general, people try to include various types of matters. For example, there have been some work by Frederick Hill to include spin fluid. There have also been some work from the string theory perspective to add something called the Cabramont field. But incidentally, it turns out that if you modify the Galileon Lagrangian, the Galileon itself can act as a source of torsion. The reason being, when you take the L3 part of the Lagrangian, then you essentially have a box which has two derivatives. So therefore, if you have torsion, this part will actually modify, and the particular Galileon field will couple to torsion. So that when you consider the variation of the Lagrangian with respect to the contortion, you can actually generate torsion. So this S mu alpha beta was actually zero in the previous case because it was in vacuum, but in presence of Galileon field, it will essentially turn out to be non-zero and depending on the derivative of the particular Galileon field. So now, sure. Now let us come to the action that we'll be working with. So first of all, I am always working in four dimensions, so it is d4x root minus. This R bar stands for the Ricci scalar in presence of torsion, so torsion is going to modify the action. The minus half del mu phi is the standard canonical kinetic term, and this particular term stands for the torsion, stands for the Galileon field, where this box is now with respect to the bar, that is in presence of torsion. And the alpha is the coupling parameter which you need and which is dimensionful. Now you vary the action, you will essentially have three parts. One part coming from the variation of the metric g mu nu, one part coming from the variation of the contortion, and one part coming from the variation of phi. So this e phi is essentially equation of motion for phi. If you had a canonical part, it would just have been box phi equal to 0, but here you will have additional contributions coming from it. This particular chi equal to 0 is essentially this equation. So therefore, this particular variation equation that I wrote down earlier essentially comes from the variation with respect to the contortion. So the only remaining thing is this quantity e mu nu and how it looks, because the idea is we want to do cosmology. So I have to add cosmological answers to it and see how the scale factor varies. So I need to know what is the structure of e mu nu. Now, to know the structure of e mu nu, essentially the field equation. So there is one more thing that I should mention. This is the commutator relation also changes, because that's essential to get this, and the definition of the Riemann as well. So now you see the commutator of the covariant derivative essentially also depends on the torsion, and there is a Riemann. Interestingly, the Riemann is anti-symmetric in the first two and the last two indices, but the interchange symmetry does not have, because torsion is present. Now you can write down the field equation explicitly. This g mu nu is our old Einstein tensor g mu nu. It has no torsion. All the torsion parts have been separated out. This t mu t nu is essentially the trace part of the torsion. This k is the contortion, and hence this is another part essentially coming from the Lagrangian. And this is where the effect from the Galileon field comes in. So after all this jugglery, let us understand what happens in the case of cosmology. So you essentially require phi to be a function of time, as is fine. But what to do with the torsion? So there can be several possibilities that one can hook up. For example, there is some model called scalar torsion, or there is again the Kalb-Ramon field. But it turns out in all these simpler possibilities, there is no way you can cross the barrier minus one third, which is necessary to for it to behave as a dark energy and to give you a late time acceleration. So therefore, if you work with the general case, then it turns out you need two independent functions, essentially, which is written here, capital T and small t, which are both functions of time. And then you essentially have an expression for energy density and an expression for pressure. If you may recall that this is the part which came from without torsion, in the absence of torsion, the both of them. And whenever torsion is present, this t and small t will appear, and hence you have a lot of additional contributions to them. So the job is, you have Einstein's equation, you have the corresponding energy density and pressure. So therefore, you have to solve them together and see whether there exists any solution which can lead to late time acceleration. So this is what has been done in this figure. So I have plotted here is the equation of state parameter, which ranges from minus 1 to 1. And what has been plotted on the x-axis is the redshift parameter, base log 10. So therefore, our current epoch would essentially correspond to this particular point. CMB would possibly correspond to somewhere here, like z equal to 1000 or something. So therefore, you can see there are several cases that appears. But there are two cases, and this black line here essentially corresponds to omega equal to minus 1 third. So whenever you have solutions for which omega is less than minus 1 third, you will have accelerating solution. But among them, for example, this particular line does not have omega equal to minus 1 here, so probably not compatible with the current observation. But there are some cases, for example, this dotted line or this particular case, where you can have omega equal to minus 1. So with this, I think I will just go to the implications. So for example, if we had the L3 term alone, that is not sufficient to get late time acceleration, as people have already noted. But there are many ways to get it. For example, as I mentioned, breaking the Galileon symmetry itself can help to achieve the late time acceleration by either using arbitrary functions of the kinetic term or including a potential even. However, if you incorporate torsion, which is very natural to arise in any gravity theory, it serves two purposes. First of all, it gives you a source for the torsion, which earlier was pretty ad hoc in the sense spin fluid or Kalb-Ramon field kind of a thing, but this arises sort of naturally. And finally, it has a few solutions which admit late time acceleration, unlike the term which is L3 here without torsion. But there are many points to be checked and many things to be done before it can be said that this is really a viable model that can explain our observable universe. For example, one has to study cosmological perturbation theory in presence of torsion, which I do not know whether it exists till date. Second, the effect on temperature anisotropy of CMB, is there any observable departure? And if there is any observable departure, is there any constraint that you can put on torsion? And possibly effect on primordial gravitational waves or effect on inflation and so on. So I believe there are many things that one can do based on this, and I hope that would be interesting to learn. So with this, I thank all of you for your attention.
Thank you. Questions? Yeah, please.
Can you go back to that plot you have just shown?
Sure.
So for this case E and case, what is the blue one is case A?
Yes, so this is essentially the case E.
Okay, whatever is the case E. So for that you have taken two functions, capital T and small t, for the generalized case, right? So this represents some kind of a special functional form of those.
It's like power law.
Okay, for the capital T and small t. Yes. Now this is, you have to put in by hand kind of?
Mathematica.
No. What I mean is that this functional forms for this capital T and small t, you are checking with different functions when you are checking this, or you have some logic behind it?
You just put some power law with keeping the power arbitrary, and then you essentially solve and see for which kind of powers you get this sort of solution.
Okay, so in that case, my question is, what is the difference between this case C and case E?
Okay, so here, for example, we have taken them to be of exponential. So
functional. Okay, that is, okay, yeah. I understand.
Okay. I think we have no time for more questions. Yeah, but
thanks.
We can talk to him later. Thank you. Thanks to the speaker again.